So turn with me to Deuteronomy chapter 8. You say, wait a minute, what happened to the rest of the Pentateuch? Well, we're going to pick up, we'll get back into it. But Deuteronomy retells some of the things that happened, and I wanted to grab a verse here from it because it relates to what we're doing. So Deuteronomy, we've been Genesis, Exodus, but today we're going to be Deuteronomy, which is the fifth book in your Bible. It's in the Old Testament. And it's still part of what Moses wrote when we start talking about context and how does this fit in the overall picture. Realize that what happens, and if you haven't seen this movie before, I'm going to spoil it somewhat. There's coming a point where the children of Israel, the people of Israel, you know, we tend to talk about children, but they're 50 and 60 years old, and I don't know if there's very many of y'all that are in your, some of them at least, many of y'all that are 30, 40, 50, 60 that like to be called children to your face, so I don't know why we still do that to the people of Israel, but God doesn't care what you call them as long as you start calling somebody else a music leader. That's just really his thing. And don't step on his toes today. Okay, be polite, be kind, and realize his feet are sunburned. Okay, so it was a sacrifice for that man to put shoes on to come to church this morning, but we appreciate it, doing. The people of Israel are going to come up to the edge of the promised land. God's going to say, go in and take it. They're going to say, no, I don't want to take it. But God's going to send them back out into the wilderness. And everybody's going to die that was an adult that decided not to go into the promised land. God's going to replace them with a whole another generation, a whole new group of adults, both leaders and followers within the people of Israel. As they then come back to the border of Israel, the Lord is then going to have Moses go back through the law with them, tell it a second time. That's what the book of Deuteronomy is. It's the second telling of the law. It's kind of a repeat and a remind of what's happening. So that's where Deuteronomy comes from. There's some other really nerdy stuff about it, about how it's laid out in a vassal suzerain treaty and all this type of stuff that we can talk about another day. We'll leave it alone for right now. That's what Deuteronomy is. We're retelling the law, okay? Moses is still your author. You're still dealing with the people of Israel somewhere around 1406 B.C. So still 3,500 years ago or so. Chapter 8 of Deuteronomy says this, carefully follow every command I am giving you, so that you may live and increase and may enter and take possession of the land the Lord swore to your fathers. Remember that the Lord your God led you on the entire journey these 40 years in the wilderness, so he might humble you and test you to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commands. He humbled you by letting you go hungry, and then he gave you manna to eat, which you and your fathers had not known, so that you might learn that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. On every word that comes from the mouth of God. So as we start to dig into this, this is where we're going to hang on to for today. Living based not on bread alone, but all the words that come from the mouth of God. Yet, a couple little points here to grab hold of. Bread, as much as it's translated generally as bread in Scripture, bread and meat are the two main words that you get that actually refer to all the food. Bread is ordinary, everyday food. Meat is special food. Okay? So, what you normally eat every day, that's bread. Now, occasionally vegetables comes up as a separate category and all that, but when he's talking about bread, he's not just talking about, that's the rolls, and then there's the rest of dinner. When he talks about the idea here, man does not live by bread alone, that's all of dinner. Okay? That's everything that you get. That's not just the chips, that's the queso and the tacos. Okay? That's everything. The special events involve, meat involves the pico de gallo that goes with it or whatever. Nah. Bread. So realize that when we're talking about bread here, we're talking about the everyday provision. Man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. And when you read this, you start, and initially you read it and go, wait a minute, he gave them manna to eat. They never really went hungry if you look at it, but they went somewhat unsatisfied and somewhat bothered because the food that they ate just wasn't enough. Why? Because he wanted them to understand the fact and the idea that it wasn't about the stuff that they had, but it was about the God that they followed. Now, how important is this passage? How important is this verse? Well, there comes a time, some 1,500 years after God gives this in Deuteronomy, that the Son of God Himself, living in sinless perfection on this earth, is tempted by Satan to set aside His mission, to set aside His obedience to His Father, because He's hungry. And Satan tempts Him to turn stones into bread. And Jesus' answer is, as it is written, man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. This is an important enough Bible passage that Jesus uses it to throw back at Satan. Probably one that we should be aware of. It's something that we should take a look at. And when Jesus brings it out, it's about obedience. Again, that obedience to God is what matters. So, what's going on here? Well, we're getting some basic instructions about what we need. And he talks about, as he goes through this, that God is testing their hearts to see if they'll obey or if they'll disobey, if they'll keep God's commands. He says, if they don't realize, and as you go on down, he talks about his provision. But then again, they're reminded in verse 6, keep the commands of the Lord. Verse 11, be careful that you don't forget the Lord. Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And yet somehow, even in the context of that, we get worried. We have the statement that people are going to forget. And we forget the Lord our God. So what do we do with that? What's the main point here? Every day, we need to make a habit, we need to make a practice of every day pouring into our hearts and our minds the Word of God. And if we're not doing that in such a way that it gets in and holds on, then we're going hungry. Not hungry in the way that, well, we went to Larry's and they were just flat out of everything. Not hungry in the way of, well, I went to the cabinets and I opened them up and there's all this food there because we just went grocery shopping and yet nothing is what I want. Some of y'all have experienced that, I'm sure. Not going hungry in the sense that, well, there's a teenage boy in the house, and so we just went grocery shopping, but now we have to go again. Some of y'all have also experienced that one. But rather hungry spiritually, and we're dying spiritually. Maybe you're not quite dying, but you wonder why there's some weakness there. You wonder why there are struggles there. You wonder why it is that when your faith comes to the test, that you struggle and you stumble. And this is the spot where, I should trot out a couple of video clips of either, marathon runners or, Ironman triathletes to kind of pop up here and have them talk about how important it is to eat right, to prepare for what they do, for the things that they go through. Or we could throw out the statistic to talk about that, for example, the MREs that the Army marches with have approximately 3,000 calories per MRE bundle. Which means that if you're in the field and you eat a couple of those a day, you're eating about 6,000 calories. The USDA recommends for a healthy adult male, 2,500 is really more than, and it's supposed to be more than enough. 2,000, they say, would be better. Why do you give 6,000 to a soldier? Because he's got a whole lot of stuff to haul around and a whole lot of stress to live under. And the last thing he needs is to have his blood sugar dip on. And we could go to all of those things and talk a whole lot about those and really try to drive home the point that if you're hungry spiritually, you're not going to get anything done. But y'all already know that. We talk about that all the time. So instead, we're going to talk about how to do it. Because I realized something as I was reading a book the other day. It's a really good book, but the guy was talking about the situation with business. And how a consultant had come in, big, fancy, important consultant, had come in and said, well, this is what you need to do. And the CEO looked at him and said, I know what I need to do. What I need your help with is, how do I do it? And sometimes I stand up here and I preach and present the Word of God and try to help you all by telling you what it is from the Word of God that we all need to do. But today we're going to talk a little about how to actually do it, instead of me saying, this is what we need to do. Best of luck, y'all, go do it. That's why last week, for example, we had prayer guides. And if you weren't here last week, there's still some up here, 13 weeks of prayer. By the way, you can just kind of save that. You know, we may have something else in 13 weeks, but you can keep praying over that list. But you can grab that list and get involved in that. How? That's why we have these cards to invite people to church, to make it an evangelism tool, to be able to share with people, because that way there's a how. So today we're going to talk about how to get the Word of God in your heart. So, first of all, if you're going to do the job, how do you do it? You need certain tools. Now you can relax and realize that I'm not going to read all these books. Second, those are all journals, which means they're blank. Reading these to you would be go like this. Line. Yeah. So, the first thing that you need, if you're going to hear from God, is you need a Bible. If you don't have a Bible, you need a Bible. If you don't have a Bible, and you know, this is about to sound like a Miranda warning. If you don't have a Bible, what can be provided for you? All we have to do is know as a church. Talk to me, talk to Brad or Walter or Andy. Let us know. Say, I don't have a Bible. I need a Bible. Youth, children's people, especially if you are underage and you don't have a Bible and you don't know how to get one, talk to your teachers. Teachers, if you have students in your classes that don't have Bibles, let me know. You need a Bible. Okay? Now, when you're talking about, and see, I have two up here with me, this one and this one. When you're talking about your daily time of taking in the Word of God, it is a slightly better tool to have a study Bible, which is, this is a study Bible, than to have one that is just text until you're really, really familiar with studying Scripture. Why? Because you ever hit something in the Bible that you go, I don't really understand that. What is he talking about? You know, when it says that he sailed for Tarshish, I wonder where that is. If you've got a good study Bible, that's in there. You need the Word of God. A good study Bible is a really helpful tool. But you need a Bible. Necessary tool. Okay? Here is a study Bible. If you need a study Bible and you don't have one, and you're not sure that you could ever figure out which one to go buy or where to go buy one, you can have this one, okay? Don't fight over it after church. If I catch y'all fighting over it, I'm going to mock you with it. Now, the next thing you need, and I'll, you know, after that, and we'll talk about what to do with it in a minute, okay? Keep in mind, we're making a list of tools right now. This is what to put in the box. We'll talk about what to do with it in a minute. You need a Bible. You need a journal. You say, I don't want to keep a diary. Didn't say it was a diary. It's a journal. It's a fancier term. This is not where you write down Dear Diary. We'll talk about what goes in a minute. Say, that looks all girly. Fine. Boat anchor. Manly. Wayne Brown. Works for anybody. You need a journal. Why? Because your mind starts going, oh, I can do all this on my phone. I can remote control the presentation from this tablet too, except when it doesn't work because it's too busy trying to upload my uplink my Facebook and downlink my Twitter and cross do my Instagram and whatever else. You know, there's value in grabbing a piece of dead tree and doing this manually. Take the time. Now, you need it bigger so that you can see it better. I understand that. They also do make super giant print Bibles. And they are not that much more expensive. Okay? They're actually good for them. They're actually great. They don't make super giant print journals because there's nothing in them. They're blank. Hey, write as big as you want to. Useful tool, journal. These simple 128 pages, front and back, take you 200 some odd days to fill it up if you use a page a day. They're $5. This is not a prohibitively expensive tool to pick up. Okay? That is cheaper than your combo meal at McDonald's that's cheaper than the pretzel crust from Little Caesars. Okay? You can do this. This will last longer too. Well, I mean, my pretzel, this is still from the first round of pretzel crust, but that's a whole other discussion. Okay? Journals. Okay? That was pretty girly. You can get a pretty girly one. You can get one with words on it. You can get a blank one. Okay? Third thing that's a tool that's useful to have is a devotional or a study book. Now, devotionals come in various forms. Some of them are monthly little printout publications like this. Some of them are whole books like this one. We'll talk about both of those in a minute, but they're useful because they help us engage with what God has taught other people before us. You say, I just want to read the Bible. I don't want to read books about the Bible. Well, that's neat. But that basically says that for 2,000 years, God's never spoken to anybody, guided anybody to understand anything, and nobody's ever been smarter than me. So therefore, I don't need anybody else's view of what's in the Word of God. I'll just have my own. Now, when you put it that way, it sounds a little bit arrogant, right? Devotional or a study book. Guess what? Many of our Sunday school books, our Sunday school quarterly materials that we get, are now actually labeled a daily discipleship guide. Oh, there you go. That's an easy grab right there. Follow that through the week, what it says to do. If you're in one of our Wednesday night studies, which by the way went great, thank y'all that showed up, participated in that. But I thought that went really well. Guess what? In God Owns It All that Doug Head is teaching, there are daily Bible study activities in letters to the church, in the seven churches of Revelation that I'm teaching. There's daily stuff. And Seamless and the latest study that Ann is teaching, there's daily stuff. Okay? You don't even have to go shopping for that. We provide those for free. Now, if you can help pay for books for like Wednesday night, it really helps. But, you know, but your Sunday school books are right there. Grab one. Or some other study books. Now, then your process. We'll come back to what to do with the tools here in a minute. First of all, pray. You're sitting down, we're talking about the action of sitting down and looking at the Word of God. Now, if you wanted to understand any other great piece of literature, the first thing that you would wish you could do is to look at the author and say, what did you mean when you said this? 9 times out of 10, when I try to write, you know, I write an email to somebody, usually I get a response back that says, what did you mean when you said this? I'll send a text message to Ann, and she'll call me and say, what? And I realized that my thumbs were off by one. It made no sense at all. Praying is the act of asking the author of Scripture, this is the Word of God, to guide you as you read it. Talk to God. Get up in the morning, begin your efforts with praying, and say, Lord, help me to focus my heart on this right here and right now. Pray. Set aside all the other distractions that you've got and pray. Leave your phone plugged in the kitchen and pray. Second, read. Now, you can substitute listen if you really need to be audio. But read. The third one is think. Not just read over it, close the door, close the book, and say, okay, we're done here. But actually think about what you've put in there. Now, to pray, first of all, to pray, you need to do it. Sometimes we get so wrapped around learning how to pray that we never get around to it. This is like somebody that attends, goes to 400, you know, dating seminars and never asks a girl out. It just seems like a great idea. I want to learn more and more about it before I do it. But ultimately, you've got to actually go for it. Many of us are the 32-year-old still living in mom and dad's house, you know, sleeping on the couch because we haven't gotten out into life with prayer because I got one more thing to learn before I can actually step out on my own. And it's nonsense. Your father says, talk to me. So first of all, start with doing it. There are wrong ways to pray, perhaps, but let me tell you this. God knows what you need before you have need of it. Jesus said that. Jesus said, what father among you, if his son asks for a fish would give him a stone, or ask for bread would give him a snake. How much more so does your Heavenly Father know? If you pray for the wrong thing, God can actually correct that and correct you. Better to be honest in prayer and in effort than to not ever get around to it. So do it. Don't say, well, tomorrow I'm going to try to learn how to pray. I'm going to try to get my prayer life organized, and then hopefully in a week or two, when I've got it organized, I can pray. You can get prayer life organized in the first half of a commercial break while you're watching NASCAR this afternoon. Write down all the people in your family and then pray for them. Don't take that long. You say, you don't know how big my family is. Fine. Maybe it takes two commercial breaks to write down all your family. Start there and start praying for them. Ideas about how to organize prayer. This is the classic one we've been teaching for years. To open with the idea of adoration. Praise God for who He is. Confession. Lord, these are my sins. You need to spend some time asking God to show you what you've done that hasn't been right. Or the things that you should have done that you didn't do. And then asking for His forgiveness. Why? Because if you start every day with that, it's a real good check on your ego, by the way. Thanksgiving. What are you thankful for? By the way, this goes in your journal. What are you thankful for? Every day, break out your journal. Your cheap, simple book. Write the day's date down. And write down three things that you're thankful for. Every day. As fixed as possible of things. Don't just say, I'm thankful to be alive. Well, if you almost died the day before, that's good. But think deeper. I'm thankful that this morning, instead of having to go out and chase chickens to have eggs, I could go to the fridge, pull out eggs, scramble them, cook them, eat them. Thankful for that. Because they were good. Okay? Thanksgiving. Things that you're thankful for. Give thanks to God for them. Supplication. That's our fancy word that we use when we talk about praying for others. Every day you ought to pray for other people. That's what that 13 weeks of prayer reminder sheet is for. That's why I have a list of everybody in this church that I pray through. Supplication. Another idea to do it, and we've done this one before. Click. Pray, repent, ask, and yield. Pray. You know, go to God, ask for things, repent of the sin that we've done, yield to His will. Now, you want to make a list? So that you keep up with stuff, which by the way is what, you know, prayer journals like this can be useful for. Here's ways to make lists. Names of people, needs of people, and stuff you see in the news. It's that simple. Names of people that you know that need something. I have names, usually they're broken down by needs. Names of people who need Jesus. Names of churches who need preachers. Names of preachers who need encouragement. Names of church members. No, I don't write down what all of you need. The Lord knows what you need. I would feel really bad if I was praying for you to get a Ford and God wanted to give you a Chevy. I mean, that would be bad. If I know that you need healing from something, maybe there's a physical illness, you know, praying for Julie to get a liver three years ago, for example, definitely pray for that. Beyond that, pray that God blesses. And then news. Look on the news. If you really need to, look at it as ways to pray. Don't look at it as ways to get angry at Pelosi or angry at Trump or angry at this one, that one, the other one. Look at it as people to pray for. That simple. Click. When you journal. So you take your prayer, okay, so your next thing in your process, this is while you're reading and thinking. Take your journal, write down the passage of Scripture that you read. So where are we going to find that passage of Scripture? I'll give you that in a minute. Write down what you read so that you can keep up with it. So that you can look and say, oh yeah, I did read this yesterday. Now here's a suggestion of ways in which to journal this. And try to take those dots off of there about 14 times. It didn't work. Write down what the highlight that stood out from what you read was. Examine. Write down what did you think, what you see, what you understand from it. How do you apply it to your life? And then what you're going to do in response. For example, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word which comes from the mouth of God. How do I apply that? I should read the Word of God every day. That's the application. What's my response? Tomorrow morning I'm going to set my alarm 15 minutes earlier, get my lazy tail out of bed, and read the Word of God. That's the difference between an application and a response. Application is, this is what it means I should do. Response is, this is what I'm going to do. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Application, I should treat my neighbor with respect and with care and compassion and hope that they come to find Jesus. Response, I'm going to stop playing really loud rock music at 1 o'clock in the morning. Okay, that's a response that I learned 20 years ago. Okay, but still, you get the idea. Highlight, examine, apply, and respond. By the way, those of you that are doing the Churches of Revelation study, that's in your book. It's in the front part of your book. Those steps, those ideas. Those of you who have, some of you have got Foundations, the Foundations New Testament Reading Plan. It's in there. Other methods, you can just write down, what are your questions? At least one Sunday night a month, you can come to church and ask whatever Bible question you've got. I can't ever remember my question. Guess what happens at lunch at my house almost every day? Questions. Okay? Applications. What you feel like God was telling you to do. What stood out from it? Write those things down. Why? So that you can remember it. So what do we do about it? First of all, do it. Set a time. Get up and get it done. So, but I'm retired. I want to sleep in. I didn't say you had to set 5 o'clock in the morning. You can set 11 o'clock in the morning. Let it be before you get started on the rest of your day and everything else in the world hates at you. By the way, leave your phone, set on do not disturb, and ignore it while you talk to the Lord. Get it done. Need a Bible? Ask. Need a devotional? Ask. Here's some Bible recommendations, though, for you. By the way, if anybody wants this stuff, I can email this list to you. Good study Bibles. By the way, you'll find these scattered around the church in various people's hands. The ESV study Bible is a good one. Now, we're not going to get into Bible translations here, but you see some of my preferred ones with these. The ESV Study Bible. The CSB Study Bible. Notice the word study, okay? The CSB Everyday Study Bible. That's what that one is. The Baker Illustrated Study Bible is this thick. It's awesome. Get the hardcover. You can break your foot, okay? It's a great Bible. Got a lot of detail. Got a lot of extra study help. But it's a fat one. The New American Standard Zondervan, that's the name you have to search for on Amazon, okay? The NIV Faith Life Study Bible, those of you that like pictures, that's a great one for you. And then this one, don't let the title intimidate you, the Biblical Theology Study Bible. These are actually on sale right now at Lifeway. They're currently sold as the NIV Zondervan Study Bible. They're on sale for $15 for a hardcover at Lifeway right now, because they're going to be printing them and releasing them with that title. Same content. Basically what they've done is they've rebranded the large cheeseburger as the super fancy large cheeseburger. It's the same thing. It's still, you know, it's still cow, cheese, and bread. Okay? Great study Bibles to look at. Devotionals. You want to get started in the habit? Here's some things to start in the habit. Stand firm. Men's ministry hands these things out for anybody that wants them, okay? We order them out of the literature budget. They come from Lifeway. If they're going to get used, we'll order more. We don't like to throw stuff away. We love to see God-honoring resources get used. By the way, there's one for women called Journey that we got for a little while, and they all got thrown away, so we stopped ordering them, but we can get them if you want them. Open Windows is not what's out there. Our Daily Bread is. But Open Windows is another devotional that we make as Baptists. There's another one that I have that I get from the Institute for Creation Research that is called, I don't remember now, but it's kind of creation-oriented. It's a good one, and I meant to bring it today and left it on my desk. But those get you started in the habit. You want to go a little deeper? You would if you could click the button. Hit the button, Jacob. There we go. My utmost for his highest. This is a classic one. You want to challenge your life, take this book and read it, okay, on a daily basis. Now, one of the things that you could get from every one of those devotionals, also New Morning Mercies and Morning and Evening from Charles Spurgeon, they all have, and that's one if you want to do in the morning and in the evening. They also have Bible passages in them. And that goes along with, if you're looking for what to read in your Bible, take a look at your bulletin. There's a Bible reading plan. If you don't like that one, email me and say, hey, help me find a different Bible reading plan. Those last three that are listed, long story short, old story new, and then God's Mighty Acts, there's two or three in the God's Mighty Acts series. Those are family devotionals intended for families. And those are great. We love those. So those are good 5-10 minute devotionals for your family. That's the last of my slides, so I'm going to turn this thing off before I click it. So what do we do with it? Well, there's a couple other options in terms of devotional books and study books. This is one of my favorites. A guy named Ken Shigematsu, he's Canadian, but he's still... You take a chapter a day or a chapter a week in a book like this. It's called God in My Everything. Challenge the way that you think. ESV, this is a devotional called Solo, meant to be, you know, by yourself. It's got passage, guideline. I'd have dove for that, but it would have hurt. Leah, would you mind to pick that up and set that on the table for me? Thank you. Yeah, but it's got Bible passages already in it. It's a great devotional. And then this one is just absolutely, you can tell this is one of my favorites. I didn't bring my copy of My Utmost for His Highest. This is a new one. My Utmost for His Highest is about to fall apart, but this one's called Awakening Faith, Daily Devotions from the Early Church. Yeah, this is like, this is what Caesarius of Arles said, and then like 3 years later he was killed for his faith. So there's a lot of that in there. So I also have one that's have two different ones that use church history elements for devotionals. There's a good set of devotionals called Then Sings My Soul by Robert Morgan. And Robert Morgan's a great guy. He's a pastor in Nashville. And he is also a hymnologist. That's his hobby. Everybody needs a hobby. His is to study the history of hymns and music. And he has written a couple of devotional books where you take a song, you take the story behind the song, and a Bible passage that goes with it. They're called Then Sings My Soul. Great books. The issue is this. It doesn't take as much time as you think it does, and it's not as hard, perhaps, as we tend to think it is. Go back to that first slide with the tools. One says tools. That's it. It doesn't take very long to get started in the habit. It doesn't take a lot of stuff. I didn't bring my stack of stuff that I use because, quite frankly, my habits are slightly different because I'm a pastor. My opportunities are slightly different because I'm a pastor. What are you going to do? Come into my office and say, hey, you shouldn't be reading the Bible, you should be working? Nobody's going to do that to the preacher. So, my habits are different. My opportunities are different. But three simple tools, a Bible, a journal, and a devotional book, and a three-step process in your morning, pray, read, think about what you read. Ask God to shine light on it, read it, jot down some of it. That's what the journal is for, to jot down just some things. This is what I thought. But you can then go back and reference. And start to live off of the bread that God provides through His Word that you need to know. Why? Because otherwise, when it comes time to be up against the test of following Christ, up against the difficulties, because we haven't done the little things day by day, we won't have the strength for the big ones. Because really, the question of our time and of our faith and of being a Christian in the 21st century in the United States of America is not some big question of whether or not we'll stand when they put up the giant statue and say, bow down to the statue, or we're going to throw you in the fiery furnace like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, or, you know, if you'd rather, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. If you'd rather use their Hebrew names. We're probably not going to see that test. The test that we're going to see is when the time comes to decide how you spend your income tax refund. When the time comes to decide how you spend your Sunday mornings. When the time comes to decide how you're going to find who you're going to marry, how you're going to choose what job path to walk through, how you're going to react to the challenges of parenting, it's the little everyday things that the world is seeing in us that'll make a difference in whether we're able to share the gospel. Just like if this building, experienced some massive calamity at the moment, we could probably all find it in the strength to surge out the back door and get into the parking lot. Most of us could muster the strength spiritually to face one big test. But I think a big part of our problem as God's people is that we don't have the daily strength. We haven't taken in the daily bread that we need to pass the everyday test. On an adrenaline rush, we could sprint 100 yards. But we haven't done what we need to be able to daily walk 200 every day across the street to the neighbor to show them the love of Christ down the road to this. Set a time, make a habit, and do it. That's what we need to do. There's some basics about how to do it. Have more questions. That's what we're here for as a church. That's what I'm here for, is to help answer those. Not to sit here and have y'all go a month and then come back and say, well, we didn't do it because we didn't understand it. If you don't understand, ask. Not right now. Because some of y'all are itching to get to Easton Cafe and I don't want to get you out of here. But ask. That's why there's a phone number and an email address on the front of the bulletin. You can get a hold of me. Now, you may try to get a hold of me while I'm doing this, and I'll get back to you afterwards. Okay? It's more important than we realize. Make this the start of your day, whatever point your day starts. Whether your day starts at 5, at 9, 10, or maybe you end up on third shift and your day starts at 8 o'clock at night. I've been there too. Pray, read, think, and follow after Christ. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for your love, your grace, and your mercy. Thank you that you brought us this far. Thank you that you've given us your word. We pray with God that we will listen to your word and honor what you told us to do. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. So as we come to the time in our service that we call our time of invitation, Scott and Carla are going to come. And we're going to sing Just As I Am. And we sang earlier a song, In Christ Alone, that talked about the gospel, about how we can have no guilt in life and no fear in death through a relationship with Christ. Because if you don't have that, none of the rest of this stuff's not really going to help you. You just have a journal full of empty scribblings. So if you need to talk about what it is to have a relationship with Jesus while we sing this song, we're all going to stand together. We're standing here at the front. Come on down and talk to me, to ask me, and I'll be glad to show you from God's Word what it is to follow after Christ. So Scott, lead us as we sing. Let's stand together.